Well, man, it's kind of like a birthday party in here. We are celebrating well, and we're celebrating how powerful God's love is. How God's love conquers even death, which is the inevitable darkest thing that we can ever face, and yet God's love overpowers it. And so, this was a whole new discovery for the followers of Jesus. They didn't see it coming. And so, let me read for you from the words of my favorite disciple, John, how his experience of Easter was. John 21-9 says this. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. And so she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one that Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb and we don't know where they put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Now they both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. That other disciple is John, and I think he's actually bragging right here. He's like, "Yeah, I started later, but I got there first." So he bent over and he looked in and he saw the strips of linen lying there, but he didn't go in. And then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and actually went into the tomb. And he saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. And the cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. And finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. And he saw, and he believed. They still did not understand from the scriptures that Jesus had to rise from the dead. So he went in, and what he saw there was burial clothes, and they were unwrapped, right? They were laying on him. And it's not something you would do if you were going to steal a body and just go and make sure that it's unwrapped before you took it. And so they believed. They knew that Jesus had risen from the dead, but they didn't understand why. And at this point, I need to make a confession. I have been a pastor for, I don't know, 20, coming up on 20 years, something like that, a while. And I never understood, really, why Jesus had to rise from the dead. Like, I know Easter's like the big celebration in the church. It's supposed to be like the big, big Sunday. But I never knew why it mattered. To me, Good Friday was always the place. I mean, when my life was an utter mess, I heard about the cross, and I knew that Jesus had died for me and took away my sins, and I had an opportunity at a fresh start, and I grabbed it, and I ran with it, and it transformed my life. And so I thought it was the coolest thing that God would love us enough to lay down his life for us. I thought it was the coolest thing that that Jesus would do this for me. Blown away by that God would think that way about us. And Easter just kind of was this awesome miracle that it was kind of like the cherry on top, you know? It's a great Sunday of forgiveness and grace, and then there's this cherry on top of Jesus actually rising from the dead. It's sort of like when you go order a burger and you get the onion rings too. That's how it felt to me. And I could intellectually tell you why it mattered. I could go, well, you know, it proves to us that we're going to have eternal life, that we don't end in death either, that God is going to bring us there. And I think it's cool that I get to know Jesus, because if he was still on the ground, I wouldn't get to know him. So that's cool too, but it didn't really matter to me. And so I was left this year going, why does Easter matter? That's what I've been thinking about all week. That's what I've been trying to prepare for. And I was planning on having this great sermon. And it was going to be like three H's for Harbor, on how to have like a happy, victorious life. And it was going to be this nice, clean package on how we can step into the Easterness of it all and have happy, victorious lives as well. But I didn't get that. Instead, God led me somewhere else. And he led me to Ezekiel chapter 37, which we'll get into in a bit. But I need to share with you maybe a little bit of why I don't think that Easter mattered to me when it normally does for other people. I have a hard time hoping. I have a weird hope muscle. It feels stunted. My mom has polio. It affected her calf, and so she wears a brace, and that muscle just never developed right, and so she has this brace, and it kind of lifts up her leg for her, and she just can't do certain things like other people. I think I have a stunted hope muscle. I can hope for all of you very well. I can look at your life and your story and go, man, I could totally see what God could do and how God could transform your life And I totally love cheering people on and walking alongside them and seeing that happen. But when it comes to me, I have a really hard time. I sort of sit there and I go, man, I don't want to get my hopes up. I don't want to get disappointed. So it's best to just assume the worst, or maybe assume somewhere near the worst, and then just roll and adapt with the punches. And maybe it'll turn out better than I think it might. But I'm not going to hope, because that's scary. And this year, in particular, my hope has been tested. It has been a dark, long, rainy winter. My brother, who does just fine up here, is like, I got to move to my other brother in Vegas because it's at least sunny there. I've got to get out of here. This place is just too dark and too depressing. We had an election. I don't know if you're happy about how it turned out or not. But in the midst of that, there's this sense of a divide in our country that wasn't there before that emerged. And it's divided by race and politics and gender issues. And in the midst of all that, we have an opioid epidemic that is wiping people out. There's escalating tensions with North Korea now. I mean, it just feels like there is so many clouds and so much storm going on that I get up and I'm like, oh. And that's not even talking about our lives, man. Just in our prayer time, we were like, job struggles are there, loss, difficult relationships. More than any other this year, I've said, life ain't easy, and I don't see how it can get back to good. It's hard for me to imagine how God could bring this back to good. Wow, buzzkill on Easter. Pastor, come on, what are you doing? Sorry to bum you all out. But it's heaviness. And there's a heaviness that is attached to life. And it's there. It's stress levels. It's fear. It's frustration. It's blame. It's anger. And for me in particular, it's undertow. I grew up in Ventura, which is a beautiful beach. And we would get out on our boogie boards, which are like styrofoam little things, and we'd lay on them, and as long as you were on top of the wave, you were good. Second, you got flipped over and life hit you a little sideways. When you got knocked down, the crazy thing about Ventura's tide is it would keep you down. You would have to fight your way back up to the top. Otherwise, you would just roll on the ground until you hit the shore. Where it reminds me of when I tried to become a lifeguard. I had worked at a camp. I'd done everything else there. I was running out of, honestly, jobs I could do at this camp. And so I'm like, I've never been a lifeguard. I stink at swimming, but sure, I'll try that. So I went to go get lifeguard certified. And one of the tests was to do this, like, treading water for, like, 10 minutes. And I'm not a very coordinated person, which is part of why I'm not in the gospel choir, because if they ask me to clap, it's going to be offbeat. So treading water was complicated anyway, and so I just remember barely being able to, like, keep the water up to my chin and attempt, and they're, like, calling out the minutes, and I'm like, I'm never going to make it. Good thing I'm in a pool full of lifeguards right now, because this could be the end. So there was this treading water that happened in life, and I don't know if you've ever felt like you're treading water, and you're just keeping your head up, and it doesn't feel like Easter. Or this victorious thing we were singing about. And then going to church on Easter wasn't all that helpful either. I've been through so many Easter Sundays where it felt like they just kind of threw out the message that day, and then they go, okay, we're going to lay out the basic gospel message for people who have never heard it. And so, just so you know, sin is real. It's a part of our lives. Jesus died for your sin, and you can be brought back into relationship with him by accepting him. Do you want to accept him? And that was like the essence of Easter service, which was great, but it didn't tell me why Easter mattered at all. And then growing up, it was always the day to pretend to be happy, because my family wasn't happy. But we pretended on Easter. So we're not going to do that. So instead, we're going to go bring this buzzkill that the pastor just brought to Ezekiel 37 and see why Easter actually matters. Ezekiel 37, verses 1 through 14. The hand of the Lord was on me. He brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord, and he set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. And he led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, and those bones were very dry. And he asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I said, O sovereign Lord, you alone know. And then he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you. You will come to life. I will attach tendons to you, and I will make flesh come on you and cover you with skin, and I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. And then you'll know that I'm the Lord. So I prophesied about what I was, as I was commanded to. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, the bones coming together, bone to bone. And I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was still no breath in them. And then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says to you. Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied, as he commanded me, and breath entered them, and they came to life, and they stood up on their feet. It was a vast army. And then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say our bones are dried up, our hope is gone, and we are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says, O my people. I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel, and then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. And when I open your graves and I bring you up out of them, I will put my spirit in you, and you will live. And I'll settle you in your own land, and then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it. This, the Lord declares. Let's pray. God, we don't know how you do it, but you do it. You bring life. And so, teach us. We give you these next 15, 20 minutes. We open our hearts to you. We ask that you would speak. Take your word and plant it deep in our hearts. Transform us. And the stuff that I say that's just chaff blow it away, Lord. But your seed that can bring life, plant it deep in our hearts. We love you. Amen. Love the question that God asks. Anytime you see God ask a question, it's a good thing to pay attention. It's a good question. And God's question is this. Can these bones live? Ezekiel has been brought down to a valley. How war happened back in those days was one army would line up on one side of a valley, the other army on the other side. And then when the sign came that everybody was ready to fight, they'd all rush down to the bottom of the valley, and there would be massive collisions of death. And then if you tried to run away, you were running uphill. Not a good plan. I mean, it's a horrible way. And so he's led into one of these valleys where there's just bones everywhere. And the question comes, can these bones live? Let me share with you a couple of my piles of bones that I have. My family is a Christian. I care very much about them. I would love to see them know the Lord. I know that what the Lord can do. So I've been praying for my family for 20 years. I want to give up. It's not happening. Hard for me to hold on to hope there. If any of you know me really well, you'll know that I can also have a depressed side. I've already kind of shared that with you with Buzzkill and the Easter service. So there's a part of that that sucks me into a cave, and it's only God's Spirit that can propel me back out to hope. I'm impatient with change. I don't like it. We are in the middle of a lot of change at this church. Change usually involves resistance and not doing things that are comfortable and conflict and all those things. I want to see the end result happen really fast. I don't like the process of change. And last but not least, I have a lack of confidence. I have a question about, am I really helping anybody with what I do in my life? It's a big question for me. We all have our pile of bones, though. That's one thing I've learned. We have a hard time believing things can get back to good. And maybe it's a wound that never heals. Maybe it's some damage like what happened to my mom's leg, but it's in our spirit and it doesn't let us keep going in the same way. By the way, if you feel like that, there's this great book, How to Get Past What You Never Get Over. I really suggest it. It's a good one. But it's a great question. Can these bones live? And it's sort of the question that comes with Holy Saturday. Poor Christina had to put up with me yesterday. Holy Saturday is like the worst day. I'm thinking about the disciples' lives on Good Friday. Like, yes, Jesus had died on a cross. Terrifying day for them, but there was a lot of adrenaline involved. Like, they were killing Jesus. They're probably looking for his followers so they can kill them too. And they're running for their lives. There's a panic involved. Holy Saturday, they are locked in a room trying to figure out what happens next. What happens from here? Can any of the stuff that Jesus did over the last 3 years make any difference now that he's dead? These guys who were walking down a road when Jesus came to them, they were downcast. They were just going back to their lives. And Jesus shows up on the road and he asks them, he goes, what are you guys talking about? And they go, haven't you heard the news? He's dead. We followed him and now he's dead, so we're just going back to our lives. And it's the question that appears on Holy Saturday or on these spots where we look around at our lives and we go, this isn't working right. Is this, can these bones live? It's really a stupid question. I mean, they're dry bones. These are not bones that, like, this is not somebody who just, like, choked on a piece of meat and it's time to give them CPR and hope that they can make it back. These are bones that are dry, very dry. And yet I love the prophet's answer. It's the place where I think where faith starts. His answer is this. Sovereign Lord, only you know what can happen with these bones. Sovereign Lord, only you know. This is the smartest answer. Mm-hmm. That prophet was a smart cat. Because he says, Lord, I don't know what you're capable of doing, but do it. Whatever you want to do, do it. You're the sovereign Lord. You're in charge, so do it. Which brings me to why Easter matters again. Easter matters because Easter is that interruption in our life where Jesus, who was killed, comes back to life against all expectation and says, the story's not done because I'm dead. There's still more life to bring. And it interrupts us and it makes us ask the question, Lord, what can you do with this hopeless situation? What can you do here? Sovereign Lord, only you know. And the beautiful thing about the Lord is he's bringing life. John 10, I can't quote the scripture enough. I have come that you might have life and have it to the absolute full. I want to give you the fullness of life. That's what God wants to do. And then you get this, Sovereign Lord, you're the one who's in charge. Only you know what can happen with this. So Easter matters because there's no hopeless situations anymore. There's no hopeless people anymore. There's no brokenness in any of our lives that is so far beyond repair that God can't fix it. That's how God brings life. And then in verse 4 through 6, he begins to describe what it looks like when God brings life. And it's not what we usually ask for. I think we ask for, like, God to fix something. God, fix it. Just fix it. And it says that now there was this rattling of bones. There was this together, let them become chicks and grow into life. And he does it in people's lives all the time. It's insanity. And it's a beautiful, beautiful reality. And it's really fun to watch in people's lives. And I want to share with you that gospel writer, John, what it was like for them. John chapter 21. They're trying to figure out what happens next. They've hid away in a room. It says, afterward, Jesus appeared to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And it happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, And the two other disciples were together. And Simon Peter said to him, I'm going out to fish. Now Simon Peter and James and John, these guys that were together, they had been fishermen before. That was their life. And so what do we do with now that Jesus is dead? Well, I guess we go back to fishing. And so they've given up. They've moved on. And the other disciples said to him, well, we'll go with you. So they went out into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. And early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore. The disciples didn't realize it was Jesus. And he called out to them, friends, have you got any fish? They're thinking, customer, sweet. Except we haven't caught anything. That's the problem. So they yell back, no, don't have any fish. And he said, well, throw your net on the right side of the boat, because that's where you're going to find some. And so they did. And when they did, they were unable to haul in the net because there were so many fish in it that it couldn't even be hauled in. And then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it's the Lord. He's back. And as soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it's the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him. He jumped into the water, and the other disciples followed in the boat, towing this net full of fish. For they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. And when they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. And Jesus said, hey, bring some of the fish that you just caught. And Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153 of them, actually. Fish, symbol of life. Can't find any in the dark, hopeless situation. And yet, Jesus appears. He says, throw your net over there. And suddenly, more life than they can handle begins to flow into them. These disciples, they had run. They were terrified. Peter said, I don't even know the guy. It's like three different people, one of whom was just a little girl. He was scared to death. And somehow he became the first pastor and began to preach. And every single one of the disciples lost their lives because they believed in this thing so much. Something changed in the reality of encountering Jesus alive that propelled them forward to give their life to this thing, to believe that life could flow. And then for 2,000 years, tons of people have encountered Jesus and have claimed that to be the most transforming thing that could happen in their life. It's an absolute crazy miracle that we are here today celebrating Jesus. That doesn't happen just in memorials. So why does Easter matter? Because the same power that God used to raise Jesus from the dead by the power of the Holy Spirit is now extended to us, put inside of us, and along with it, the love of a God who says, I want to give you life. I want to give you life to the full. And to what purpose? Ezekiel 37 says, so that you may know that I am God. Which seems kind of like an egotistical thing to do, right? I'm going to do this great miracle just so that you know that I am God. It's almost like God's like tired of people not recognizing him. But that's my own insecurities. I don't think God has the same insecurities. It's not like God needs the extra attention. He's not like sitting at home going, man, I wish someone would call. It's not that. It's because God is the giver of life, and he wants to give life, and he wants to give it to everybody. And the only way that happens is when we go sit under God and go, you are him. It's almost like God is this faucet pouring out, and we're cups are all over the place. And every now and then we go, oh yeah, God's in charge. Let's go put our cup under there, and life begins to flow into us again. That's why I come to worship each week. I don't always feel it, but it's a reminder, and it brings me back to the place where I can get poured into again. I was had a great walk this week. I do walks with people, and they're fun. I had a great walk with someone, and we were talking about being thirsty. And I think we're all thirsty, and we're all thirsty for life. But we forget where to find it. And that's why God says, so that you may know that I have done this. Just give it a shot and see how the dry bones come to life. Easter matters because it takes the spots that life creates in us, the hard spots in our hearts, the hard things that we have to go through, the brokenness that comes along the way, the brokenness of the world. And as Jonathan read that Revelation passage, the place we're headed is a place where there everything is set right. Nothing's out of joint. There are no more tears. There's no more sorrow. There's no more injustice. Can you imagine a world without injustice? Where people live their best selves out all the time with God present, and where the diversity is unbelievable. And yet it all works in harmony. That's where we're headed. And God says, yeah, it looks impossible, but I can do it. And the reason you know I can do it is because Jesus was raised from the dead. And now that same power I'm going to put in you, in you, in you, in you. And then I'm going to invite you to get in sync with me, and life is going to flow into you and through you. I told you I'm kind of a depressive person. I have hope for the next year, because that is my reality. Because God pours into things and transforms them, even in ways that I can't see. So it really doesn't matter what I believe is possible. What can God do with dry bones? Well, I don't know, but he's in charge. That's where I land. I'm going to close with this. One of the places I get to work on my sermon is in our house, and we have this window that overlooks some water, and I get to watch the big container things. The big container ships go. And so I've been trying to learn about them. And Fred Dahl is a part of our congregation, and he used to run tugboats. So I've been trying to learn about tugboats because I like Fred. And I've learned about these giant ships, and they are incredible. They're huge. Like, they can't stop or turn for anything. But they can sure carry a lot. They are carrying millions of dollars. And should a small accident occur, it's really, really bad. So, like, 2007, a boat managed to hit, like, part of the Bay Bridge and get a little crack in it, and thousands of gallons, like 50,000 gallons of fuel went into the bay. And 7,000 birds died, and $40 million of cleanup happened after that. I mean, the consequences of that are amazing. But that's just money and birds and water. And we're talking about lives, which I think are even more important. There's this cool thing that happens. So when a boat comes in, it's heading towards harbor, the tugboats come along and they help steer it and push it into the right place. But there's this guy called the pilot. And he's a local guy who knows the water. He knows where to go. He knows what's hidden under the water, where to keep things so that they come in nice and clean. And he comes over to the boat, and he gets on. But the cool thing is, he doesn't actually take charge of the boat. He doesn't actually get to grab the wheel at all. He gets to be the navigator, and the captain is still in charge. He's still driving that boat. But a captain's pretty fool if he tells the navigator, like, shut up, I got this. Because he's probably going to hit something, and horrible things will come about. So instead, this pilot comes on. He's got a deep knowledge of everything that's under the water, how fast to go, where to turn, and how to turn. And he begins to tell the captain, here's what you do. Here's how you navigate this. And if you do this, it will produce great things. And it's very much what happens in our lives. The Lord is alive and well. He's knitting us together. He's stitching life back into us. And the way that he does it is he comes aboard and he says, here's how you do it. Will you let me guide you? And to the extent that we do, life comes. And unbelievable, unimaginable things that we can't conceive of will happen as we do it. So what a gift. A God who loves us, a God who's so powerful that he can bring life to situations that are hopeless and dead, and a God who comes alongside us and says, I love you, and here's where I'm taking you, and it's really, really beautiful, and you can't imagine how good it is. So, we're the harbor. Our logo's a boat plowing through the waves. Let's keep doing it, but let's do it recognizing who's in charge, and that we have a God who loves us. And whose power is unstoppable. Let's pray. God, thank you that you are so, so powerful. But that would just be scary. But that you couple that with the fact that you love us and that you know life through and through. So guide us, direct us. Lord, we put ourselves into your hands as much as we are able. Show us how to do that one more time in one more way. We want life. And we want you. Amen.